morning. Welcome to West Swamp Mennonite Church's morning worship service. We are not at church. We are coming to you live from my kitchen. The weather kind of played a nasty trick, so we are coming from the kitchen. As we continue to worship apart physically, we are still connected through the Holy Spirit as the body of Christ. Lent has begun, the time when we follow Jesus on his journey toward the cross. Today, the voice of God pierces the deep, calling us to deep relationships. With the floodwaters of Noah behind us and the waters of baptism holding us, our relationship with God established our identity with other people and with the world we live in. Let's prepare our hearts and minds for worship.
Thank you.
God, we are here at the water's edge, casting off from shore.
Into unknown waters.
With fear and trembling, we drop our oars.
Letting them go, trusting the sea.
God, we trust the signs of your covenant. The ark through the water, the waters of baptism.
The bow in the clouds, and the dove from the heavens.
We call out to you as you call us deeper into steadfast love.
Road I travel, wider than the gap you filled, deeper than my view of grace, higher than this worldly place, longer than this road I travel, wider than the gap you filled. Your love is deep, your love is high, your love is long, your love is wide, your love is deep, your love is high, your love is long, your love is wide, your love is deeper than my view of grace, higher than this worldly place, longer than this road I travel, wider than the gap you filled, deeper than my view of grace, higher than this worldly place, longer than this road I travel, wider than the gap you fill. So who shall separate us? Who shall separate us from your love? Nothing can separate us.
Sinking down, when I was sinking. Hi, everybody. Do you know what's in here? Yep, it's water. Do you know how much water is in our bodies? 60 to 70% of our bodies is made up of water. Our many organs and body parts contain water, like our brain, our lungs, our heart, kidneys, skin, and even our bones. Do you know what percent of the earth is made up of water? About 71%, with the oceans, rivers, lakes, and so forth, so much water is all around us. This room has about 20 teaspoons of water in it right now. Water exists in the air as water vapor, in rivers and lakes, in ice caps and glaciers, in the ground as soil moisture, and even in you. Water never sits still. God's presence is very much like water. God's presence is everywhere, all around us, and even in us. God is life-giving, and God's Spirit is always moving like water. So when you're feeling down, upset, or afraid, just remember, like the water that we don't see in the air, or the water that we don't always feel in our bodies, we can trust that God's presence is always there with us. Pray with me. Dear Jesus, thank you for the water you created, and thank you for being like water. Thank you that your Holy Spirit is always around us and in us to help us feel brave and help us feel loved. In Jesus' name, amen.
Genesis 9:8-17. Then God said to Noah and to his sons with him, I now establish my covenant with you and with your descendants after you, and with every living creature that was with you, the birds, the livestock, and all the wild animals, all those that came out of the ark with you, every living creature on earth. I establish my covenant with you. Never again will all life be cut off by the waters of a flood. Never again will there be a flood to destroy the earth. And God said, "This is the sign of the covenant I am making between me and you and every living creature with you, a covenant for all generations to come. I have set my rainbow in the clouds, and it will be the sign of the covenant between me and the earth. Whenever I bring clouds over the earth and the rainbow appears in the clouds, I will remember my covenant between me and you and all living creatures of every kind. Never again will the waters become a flood to destroy all life. Whenever the rainbow appears in the clouds, I will see it and remember the everlasting covenant between God and all living creatures of every kind on earth." So God said to Noah, "This is the sign of the covenant I have established between me and all life on the earth."
From the Gospel of Mark, chapter 1. At that time, Jesus came from Nazareth in Galilee and was baptized by John in the Jordan. Just as Jesus was coming up out of the water, he saw heaven being torn open and the Spirit descending on him like a dove. And a voice came from heaven, "You are my Son, whom I love. With you I am well pleased." At once the Spirit sent him out into the wilderness, and he was in the wilderness 40 days, being tempted by Satan. He was with the wild animals, and angels attended him. After John was put in prison, Jesus went into Galilee, proclaiming the good news of God. "The time has come," he said. "The kingdom of God has come near. Repent and believe the good news."
Water has held us, moved by creation. Out of dark chaos, broke forth the light. Up from the deluge, showing God's promise, has come a rainbow, gladdening sight. Water has cleansed us, bathed with forgiveness, has with clear blessing washed sin away. Jordan's strong currents, God's Son announcing, made a beginning, baptismal day. Water has touched us, fresh on our foreheads, showing an inward spiritual grace. Into God's family we have been welcomed. As sons and daughters, we take our place.
So we have made the story of Noah's Ark into a children's story. We have turned it into something that we tell children. We make toys out of it. We do nursery wallpaper with it. But when you think about it, the story of Noah's Ark is a story of tragedy, but also hope. It is the story of the destruction of almost all the life on the earth in a flood of water. But out of that flood, one family is saved along with a vast array of livestock. And they are the ones that God chooses to recreate life on the earth. As we begin Lent this Sunday, with the first Sunday in Lent, we are beginning a journey with Jesus of taking out things from our lives to make more room for God in our lives. And so we look this Sunday and in beginning at that story of Noah's Ark. And after Noah and his family came out of the ark, after the animals came out of the ark, God spoke to them in Genesis chapter 9, and God made a covenant with them, and God said that God would never again cause death on the earth by sending a catastrophic flood like that to destroy all life on earth. And God said, "This will be the sign of my covenant with you. There will be a rainbow in the sky whenever there's rain. And so whenever you look and you see the rainbow, you can remember my covenant with you, never to destroy all life on the earth again." Now, what made it necessary? What made it God's desire to wipe out all life on earth like God did? There is a place in Genesis where it talks about humanity, and it says all the imaginations of the thoughts of their heart were only evil all the time. This increase in sinfulness, this increase in rebelliousness against God, was what caused God to destroy almost all life on earth. And so we recognize, this is a way for us to recognize that sin is serious, that sin has consequences. We don't like to think about sin very much. We don't like to talk about sin very much. We say, you know, we're Mennonites. We don't really do that. We're good people. We're upstanding citizens. We don't need to talk about sin very much. But we need to talk about sin in our world today. Because one of the things that we recognize in our world today is that sin exists not just as one person doing something bad to another person, but sin is also systemic. Sin is also pervasive in our society. So when we have conditions in our society that keep people in poverty, when we have conditions in our society where it is more likely that a young black man will go to prison than that he will to college, that is systemic evil, that is systemic sin that is baked into the structures of our society. And that is part of what God is calling us to work against in our world. That's part of what it means to be a follower of Jesus, to set ourselves in opposition to those societal forces. And so when God says, "I'm going to set my bow in the sky, I'm going to set the rainbow in the sky to remind you that I'm never going to create catastrophe on earth like that again," what that is for us is it's a sign of hope and it's a sign of promise that God wants to use us to make a difference in our world. God wants to use us as the people of Jesus to make our world a better place, to eliminate those kinds of systemic evil from our world, so that we can live as sisters and brothers, so that we can live in community, so that everybody has an equal opportunity to be who God is calling them to be who God created them to be. The other passage that we're looking at together this morning is from the Gospel of Mark, and it starts off with Jesus having been baptized by his cousin John in the Jordan River. And there is a reminder there, and a voice came from heaven, "You are my son whom I love, with you I am well pleased." And Jesus heard that voice from heaven as he was baptized. Jesus heard the voice of God saying, "You are my son, with you I am well pleased." And we've talked about this before, but that's a reminder for us that we can live in light of the reality that we are God's beloved children. And that should mean all the difference to us. That should make all the difference to us that we are God's children. We are God's daughters and God's sons. And we can live in the knowledge that we are well loved by God. That was a powerful encouragement to Jesus, because then the text tells us that the Spirit of God, that same Spirit who had descended on Jesus like a dove at his baptism, that same Spirit sent Jesus out into the desert. And what that means for us is that God is willing to sacrifice our happiness for our holiness. God is willing to allow us to experience adversity so that we become the kinds of people that God wants us to be. Now, this isn't the kind of thing that we would ordinarily sign up for, right? We say, well, God wants me to live a life that's peaceful. God wants me to live a life that's joyful. God wants me to live a life that's comfortable. Well, I don't know that God wants us to live lives that are comfortable. I think that God allows adversity to come into our lives so that we can become the kinds of women and men that God desires for us to be. And so the Spirit of God sends Jesus out into the desert for 40 days to be tested by the devil, to be tempted, and to live there out in the desert, to be fasting for 40 days and 40 nights. And if God is willing to allow that into the experience of Jesus, then certainly God is willing to allow adversity into your experience and my experience. And the question becomes for us not whether or not adversity is going to come into our lives, because certainly it will, but the question becomes for us, when adversity comes, what are we going to do with it? How are we going to respond to it? How are we going to handle it? Because things can happen to us in life that present us with a choice. We can either allow them to make us bitter, or we can allow them to make us better. We can become the people that God wants us to be, and it all depends on how we respond to those circumstances that come our way. We can either spend our time saying, "Oh God, why me? Why is this happening to me?" As if to say that we want to get out of that circumstance. Or we can say, "Oh God, why in your design, in your plan, is this happening to me? Why has this circumstance come into my life? What kind of use do you want to put this adversity to in my life? How do you want to use this to help me help other people? How do you want to use this to help me become the person that you want me to become?" Jesus is our model, and he experienced testing, and he experienced adversity in life. And that shows us that we can also experience adversity, and we can come through it to the other side knowing that we are becoming who God wants us to be, knowing that our characters are being formed into the image of Jesus, that we are being recreated to be the women and the men that God wants us to be. And so we don't have to get bitter. We don't have to spend a lot of time decrying our circumstances or wishing the adversity away, but we can say, "God, make use of this in my life. Make use of me to be a blessing to other people because of this experience in my life." Then Jesus goes on from that place. He comes out of that experience of testing. The scripture tells us that he was out there in the wilderness with the wild animals, and the angels came and ministered to him. And then he went back into society. He went back into the community of humanity, and he heard that his brother John had been, his cousin John had been put into prison. And then he began his preaching ministry. He began to proclaim the gospel, saying, "The time has come. The kingdom of God has come here. Repent and believe the good news." Now that is a text for us for Lent, because Lent is a season of solemn repentance. Lent is a season for us to look inside ourselves and to take stock of where we are as people, to take stock of where we are as followers of Jesus, and to say, "Who do I need to become to be all that God wants me to be? Who do I need to become to be the person that God dreams of me being?" And so Lent is a time for us to practice repentance, to be turning away from a life that's directed by self, to be turning away from a life that's directed toward our own desires, and to be turning toward a life that's directed toward God, a life that's wide open to God's purposes for our lives, that's wide open to God's dreams for our lives. And so Jesus says, "The time has come. Repent and believe the good news." And that's the invitation that I want to give you this week, is to turn away from yourself and to turn toward God in this season of Lent. Amen. So one of the really great things about pre-recording my sermon is that when I get to the end of it and I realize that I've done something that I didn't intend to do, I can go back and fix it. So in some ways, this is kind of a sermon do-over. One of the things that I wanted to make clear that I don't think was clear enough in the first part of the sermon is that I don't believe that God sends bad things into our lives. We are broken people, and we live in a broken world. And so because of that, bad things happen to us. But God doesn't cause those things to happen. But what God is able to do is to take the bad things that happen to us and then to use them to bless us, to use them to do good to us, and to use them to do good through us to our neighbors. In the book of Genesis, Joseph talks to his brothers when they've finally been reunited, and he says this to them. He says, "You meant it for evil, but God meant it for good to accomplish the saving of many lives." So God could take those evil things that Joseph's brothers did to him, selling him into slavery, putting him down the well, all those things, and God could turn that into the rescue of the entire nation of Egypt and the entire people of Israel. And in the same way, God can do that in your life and in my life. God can take awful things that happen to us that are not sent by God, but God can use those experiences to bless us. God can use those experiences to help us become who God wants us to be. Some of you know that I was married before Sue and I were married. And probably the most traumatic thing that's ever happened to me was when my first marriage died. It was an incredibly discouraging, depressing time in my life. It was a time when I doubted everything about myself, when I doubted everything that my life was built on. And one of the things that, and it took me a long time to recover from that. It took me a long time to get to the place in my life where the most significant thing about me was not that I used to be married. But one of the things that God has used that experience to give me is an incredible amount of compassion for people who are having family difficulties, for people who are in family crisis. And so that is the way that God has taken just an awful circumstance in my life and used it to bless me, and then used it to make me a blessing to other people. And so that's what I want you to think about when you think about adversity in your life, is not that you've done something that God has caused this to happen to you, but that the circumstance has just come into your life, but God is able to use it if you allow God to. Amen.
My words for the prayer of confession will be on the screen, and I invite you to say them with me. Deep calls to deep. We call to you from the depths of our hearts.
We confess when we have stayed too close to the surface, avoiding you, avoiding our neighbors. We confess when we have felt in over our heads, needing you, needing our neighbors. Deep calls to deep. You call to us from the depths of your love.
Calling us to deep relationship, we come to you, God.
Feet may fail.
this week we want to pray for Mark Kimmerer's brother-in-law, Craig Fly, who had surgery this week for bladder cancer. We want to continue to pray for Scott Moyer, who is having radiation treatments for the lesions on his brain. We want to pray for Bob Allen, who is continuing to receive chemotherapy for lung cancer. Bob had a transfusion this week of red blood cells to help his red blood cell count. We want to continue to pray for our world, which is continuing to be impacted by the coronavirus pandemic. We want to pray for doctors and nurses and other healthcare workers as they care for those who are affected. We want to pray for the rapid and equitable distribution of immunizations for the coronavirus. We want to pray for an end to racial inequity in our country. We want to pray for racial justice in our country. And so I invite you to pray with me. God, we offer to you these concerns. We pray that your hand would be stretched out in healing to touch bodies that are ill. And God, we pray for Craig. We pray for Scott. We pray for Bob. God, we pray for our world that the pandemic would come to an end. And God, we pray for our country that there would be an end to racial inequity. And God, we ask all these things of you who live and reign with your Son in the unity of the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. Shallows of our lives into deep relationship. God requires our trust and vulnerability as we reach out to a neighbor, bursting the surface bubbles of our lives and striving for deeper understanding. Go into the week before you. Amen.